tapestry of faith is kind of a twofold. So within the cosmic womb, there is this kind of energy called the tapestry of faith, and it is created by this giant cosmic spider called Prime Weaver. And every time there is a moment where someone experiences a song of resilience, like a moment in their life where they realize that they actually were strong enough to do something that they didn't think that they could, or someone encourages them in a way that changes their path for their life in a significant manner, those kind of songs are kind of plucked out of the air by the spider, and she weaves them together like strands into this tapestry of faith. And the more she weaves it, it vibrates almost like a harp, and it sends that energy out into dreams to remind people, you know, you can get through this, you're strong enough. But in the real world, I believe that all of us have kind of the opportunity to contribute to this larger tapestry of faith, regardless of the religion that we come from or spirituality, where the kindness and the thoughtfulness of our hearts and what we do for ourselves and others to show our love to one another just continues to grow this tapestry, that when you take all those memories of people who have lifted you up over the years, that have made you feel like you're enough, and you're able to take that tapestry and just wrap it around yourself during those hard times, or when you're having a moment where you really need to feel strong, you can grab your tapestry like a cape, you know, and feel like a hero. I think that it, you know, it's a form of reflection, gratitude, and really looking at the fact that we don't go on this journey alone, but that there is this tapestry of people and the experience and the things that they do that help us move forward on our journey. In the beginning, the cosmic womb, before it had its name, I mean, it was kind of a coping mechanism as a child. Like, I was always writing stories. Even before I could write words, I was a really bossy child, and so I would tell my babysitter to write down the words, and then I draw the pictures. So there's these pictures of the moon dogs. They were like these characters I had made up as a kid, and the moon dogs would get stuck in a maze, so I just draw this like really abstract angular purple thing with a crayon and be like, that's the maze, you know. And you know, for Prince Amos, the first mouse to go to the moon, was a book I typed when we got our first word processor in my in first grade. It was like a huge deal, and we bound these books, and I still have that book. And Prince Amos is actually a puppet now, and has broken down in some dance moves in some of the videos, and is in some of the paintings. And so some of these characters start all the way back to like kindergarten, first grade. But when I was working on my thesis in grad school, that's when I really started to realize I needed to consolidate this into one kind of world where there were parameters and rules. Because if I'm kind of floating across all these different mediums, I'm using paint, animation, video, sculpture, I needed some kind of structure to rein myself in, to base all the work on, or I'd just start doing whatever I wanted, and it would just, there wouldn't be any challenge as to the, you know, the parameters or rules that could be like slightly bent or broken to rebel against, you know. And you, at least for myself, those parameters are really important. So to create this imaginary world where there's a structure and you're trying to problem solve constantly, well, if this is how this world is organized, do I need to create some new planets? Do I need a new character to come? Do I have to study time traveling to figure out how all these characters could have lined up for the timeline to work? And so it constantly brings in this excitement of researching and learning about the real world in history and science, and then figuring out how to blend that into this imaginary world. There's so much about being an adoptee that is integral to the work. I mean, I'm of the mind that all artists, what we do is autobiographical, whether we like it or not. I think for me, probably the genesis of trying to organize my feelings about my adoption and then also as an artist was every time I was searching for my birth family, I'd have to call this phone number, and they would say, well, we don't know your case number, so it's going to take us a while to look up your case to find your family. And I'd say, I'm K83-3696, which was my case number. And I actually, one of my youngest photos of myself is a little mugshot of me with that number across my chest. And so I took the number K83-3696 and I made characters, the main characters of the cosmic womb, named after them. So Lady K is the forest ranger of that world. 83, which is spelled like A-I-D-E-E, 83. She's a scientist who can shoot electricity out of her fingers. 36 Emo Flowers is her full name. She can turn into flowers, even on wallpaper, and disappear, and then jump out of the wallpaper and get a bad guy. And 6 and 9, Big Six, is like this punk rocker who's featured in Spectre Force 5. And Novum 9 is kind of this Kill Bill type character with a big sword, and her hair is always in her face, and very mysterious. So it was kind of fun to take something that could have been perceived as kind of a sad thing, this little black and white mugshot photo of a child where their name was reduced down to a series of numbers and letters, and to transform that into this key group of characters that are so powerful to the genesis of the cosmic womb, and they were the key to help me find my birth family. So it was kind of nice that both of those things kind of came together. I've always been kind of drawn to these really kind of strong, bold color palettes. I mean, part of it, when I went to Korea National University of the Arts to study for a semester, a lot of my colleagues in my class were shocked that I used this color palette because I didn't grow up in Korea. And so a lot of them were determined to believe that it was genetically part of my being that I was using these colors, because they're like, these are Korean colors. Like, and I was like, no, these are just colors that look good together. But I think because I had such a love of animation growing up, I didn't go to many museums. I think I went to 2 art exhibitions that I can remember as a child. My family didn't really do things like that, but I did watch a lot of TV. And because of the nature of cell animation, usually they use solid, bright colors to fill in, you know, each of the different parts for these animated acetate cells. And so I think I took a lot from cell animation and the brightness of the color, and then it being photographed under high light, you know, to make the colors pop. And also, being a kid of the 80s, a lot of that was to sell toys. So you've got these characters that are like candy just jumping around on the screen. So, I mean, I associated that with goodness, with wonder. I mean, Pee-wee's Playhouse was one of my favorite television shows as a kid, because they got to scream a lot and the adults never got mad at them for like yelling the word of the day. And I thought, what a great place where kids were allowed to just be kids, where like, everybody knows that children are designed to yell and scream, and it's celebrated. And with all these candy-colored pterodactyls and robots, and so I think that I associated color from a young age with freedom, you know, with this joy to be yourself. And I think that also when you're trying to talk about really challenging things. I've talked about this multiple times in previous artist talks, that Roger Rabbit is my favorite film of all time. And that film aesthetically has this beautiful, lush color to it. When they go into Toontown and you see all the birds and the dancing flowers and all these ridiculous things happening. But that film is about gentrification. It's about a corrupt judicial system that treats the people of color, which are the animated characters, much differently than the human physical people. And even in the novel that it was based on, it was even more segregated, the roles between humans and cartoons. And I think that for me growing up, there was these deeper messages that I could kind of get, but I was sucked in by the color. And so as I've gotten older and come to understand that film and its complexity, I'm glad that it entranced me with the color first, and then as an adult has grabbed me with its deeper messages. A lot of my villains are just out of necessity. So, you know, if I have friends that maybe they have a unhealthy relationship with like a teacher or a parent or somebody who's just like a bully in their life, I might transform that person or the energy of that person into some kind of character where I want to see my friend as a imaginary character confront their fears or confront this bully in their life. And so that has been a great way for me to kind of, I don't know, take out my own feelings about what's happening when there's unusual or unhealthy power dynamics in the real world, and to be able to consolidate them into different characters. And I'd say that the thing that's fun about characters like Lady Madness is, I mean, I grew up where if you got sick, you got to watch like certain TV shows on cable or like reruns, and they would play the old 1960s Batman. And so I don't know, I feel like there's something healing about the original Batman TV series, probably because I always watched it when I was at home sick with a cold. But I always loved how villainous the villains were. Like they never were deceitful or lying about the fact that they were bad. They were like, oh, it's so delightfully wonderful to be good, to be bad. It's so good to be bad, you know, that kind of idea. And there was something about that, I really appreciated their honesty. Like they weren't pretending that they were anything else than a dastardly villain, you know? And we can take away those types of memories and the power that are behind those memories of the times where we've dealt with explosive people, or we've dealt with people who almost kind of get their nourishment from making other people sweat or making them, you know, feel like they need to whine or cry, that they're feeding off of that. When we can laugh at that and be like, how pathetic, how silly, you know, how cartoonish, we can take that bully power away. And I like that. Growing up, I lucked out that the community theater group in my town, the woman who ran it, there was this Immaculate Heart of Mary Church that would do like a variety show every year. And even though we weren't Catholic, we were Protestants, and my family would like sign up to help volunteer for this other church's big variety show every year. And the director of it, Sharon Welcome, I used to call her Ms. Beautiful, that was her nickname. She would cast me in roles that nobody else would cast me as because they saw me as Asian first. But because she liked my voice and she knew I loved dancing and performing, she let me be the first Asian Dorothy for the variety show for our Wizard of Oz sequences. And so when I got to put on those ruby red slippers and put on that dress, and they braided my hair, and they didn't try to, you know, dye my hair a different color or, you know, lighten my skin. She just thought as I was the best Dorothy there. And those kinds of moments made it easier as an adult to then say, I really like She-Ra. I want to create a character that's very similar to She-Ra and Jem and the Holograms. And so creating C.S. Watson, who can, you know, wave her magic wand and transform into cosmic creator and shoot, you know, paint plasma blasts out of it and ride a giant rabbit across the stage and fight bad guys, you know, it came so much more natural to think, oh, well, I can just sub this face for this face, you know. It became more complex when I started working on Spectre 4-5 because I started script writing. And that's where I started to learn how you can actually break down through a lot of script software how many times people speak. And you can actually see, okay, I have this many female characters speaking, this many lines. This is how many non-binary characters are speaking, or transgender characters that are female or male. And to be able to kind of get an understanding of my own mind of how much I was letting people talk, and even more importantly, whether they were saying key points that were going to move the story along. And when I started to notice when I was studying film while working on the project, that a lot of times people of color would say things in film that white people had already said, and they were just repeating them, or they were used as someone to be corrected constantly. And that what they were saying really didn't matter. And so that really was an amazing test for me to kind of go through and say, what are my own internalized issues as to who I let have significant roles within my own storytelling, and how can I challenge that by really breaking it down and seeing, I want to make sure that each of these characters contributes something significant to the story. I was listening on the radio to NPR interviews with people who, early on in the discussion about human rights when it came to the transgender community, and they were doing kind of the beginnings of understanding how to do therapy with people who were, it wasn't about their gender, it was about the therapy of dealing with family members maybe that didn't understand what they were going through, or society that didn't understand them. And the woman said that by the end of her studies working with these people, that she realized the most painful thing in the world is for people to not give you the time and space to be able to acknowledge you exactly as you are. And how simple and easy it is to just respect people enough to use their pronouns, to use their chosen name, and how much it hurts and cuts like a knife when people just don't want to see you. And so I hope that my work, through these ideas of these heroic, adventurous stories, we fall in love with these characters. So even if you live in an area where you don't get a chance to, say, meet different types of people that have identities that you're not as familiar with, you can become very familiar with these characters. And as you fall in love with them, I hope that it can build a sense of empathy and compassion to want to call these people by their proper names, to call them by their proper pronouns, and to respect their identities the same way that you can then model that behavior when you finally meet someone who shares these identities. Growing up in the 80s and 90s, there were superheroes that were made for a certain time, but a lot of them, there were some that reflected my identity as an Asian person, and I'm a huge fan of Marvel Comics. But a lot of times, when you would have a character of color, it would be because of something magical that happened to them, that they were originally white, and then they got kidnapped by ninjas, and then magically became some kind of Asian person, versus them being allowed to just be a person of color who has extraordinary gifts. And so I felt for myself that I wanted to create a world where we could see these types of people from all different types of backgrounds become significant characters that someone could pinpoint and make them the hero of their kind of world of fandom, versus it being having to choose the sidekick, like the Asian scientist or, you know, the Asian kid who's good at math or inventions, where they become more like a prop or an object. And I think that's how we want to feel as people, is that we are significant in a way that if we weren't here, other people's lives wouldn't be the same. And so if I can make characters that feel that same way, that make us feel like if this character wasn't part of the story, it wouldn't have been as full, it wouldn't have fully made sense. That's part of the goal with the types of heroes that I'm creating. They're in an interdependent relationship that reflects so much more the reality of our world, where we are all connected and we all have relied on each other for one thing or another in a good way, and to be able to celebrate that within the work.